gather and give rejoicing and praise for the ways that God has been active in our lives and continues to be so today and tomorrow. And as we come and give joy and praise, we also come as a time of reflection, a time to acknowledge the ways that we are broken in our lives and in our world. So with that in mind, let us turn to God in prayer for silently, and then I will lead us in a spoken prayer. Let us pray as God's people. God, our refuge, you hear our cries for mercy. You lift the lowly and offer hope to the hopeless. But we who benefit from your grace do not emulate you and your ways. We are quick to condemn, exaggerate, critique, and act mercilessly. We confess the ways that we demean and dehumanize others. We pray for your forgiveness. In the name of Christ, who showed us how to live, we pray. In his name, amen. Let us continue as we sing Holy, 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 which is hymn number 595 in the hymnal. Let us join together and hear these words of assurance. God judges the people with equity and guides the nations of the earth. Today we come together and show our reverence for God and acknowledge that in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Let us respond with, thanks be to God. Amen and amen. For we celebrate, for we are forgiven people and we acknowledge that and we celebrate that and we pass that from one to another. So let's share God's peace from one to another. Peace be with all who are joining us online today, and that peace is real and transformative. You may be seated. I invite the kids forward at this time with Miss Christina over here with the children. You got it?
Right over here. Would you like me to? You okay? Good. Okay. Hi, everyone. Good morning. How's everyone doing? I'm so glad to be here with you. Everyone looks so wonderful. So raise your hand if you have started school. Yeah? Is everyone having a good year?
Yeah.
Awesome. You're not? It's kind of, well, I think it'll get better for you. So I wanted to talk to you guys about I want to talk to you about brownies. Does anyone here like brownies?
I love brownies.
Yeah?
I love brownies.
Do you love it more than cake, or do you just love brownies? Like, do you love cake more? Yeah, I know. They're so good. Oh, he likes the Domino's. Well, what I brought here was a brownie mix. And you see on the back, have you guys made brownies before? Okay. So when you have your brownies and you buy them in this box, it tells you, like, it shows you on the front what it's supposed to look like, right? And then it tells you on the back how to make it. This is your recipe. So everything you need as far as the mix is in here. Okay. So have you guys, when you opened the box and you poured it into a bowl, what happened? Yeah, you start with the brownies. And when you put them in there, do you think like it puts a little bit of dust that comes up when you pour it in the bowl? Do you remember that? So maybe you went really slow when you poured it in the bowl, if you go too fast, it makes a dust. So what I want to talk to you about is when you're making things, even like friendships, yeah, sometimes if you go too fast and you maybe say things that you shouldn't say or don't mean to say, maybe you have like an accident in the way you do something or what you say, you think maybe I just messed up this friendship I'm trying to grow because you're back in school and you want to have a friendship with the person you sit next to. But what happens is sometimes it's okay to have that, and sometimes you just have to think, I still can make brownies with this. So when I put my mix into the mixer, you know, and it has something that automatically stirs it for me. Do you guys know what that is? Something that stirs?
A mixer.
Yeah, a mixer. So you put it in the mixer, and if you turn the mixer on too fast, too high, what happens? Do you remember? Yeah, it's everywhere, right? And so then you look at your brownie pan, and you look at your bowl and you think, there's no way I'm gonna make all the brownies that I should have made. Because now, where's half of the mix? It's gone, it's on the floor. So you might have to get another box, but maybe you only have one box. So you're just gonna have to make do with what you have in the bowl. But guess what? If you were going a little bit slower, we took our time a little bit more, we thought about it, then we would have more brownies because we would have more mix still. Is that right?
How about we make brownies for God?
Yes, well, when you get home, you certainly can make brownies for God. And I think that's a great idea. And there's even ones down here with M&Ms. So just remember when you're starting to grow a friendship or you want to, do something special, just take your time. Just be careful that you don't say things. Maybe words come out too fast, like maybe you're angry, you're scared, you don't know what the person is going to say to you. You can just be quiet and listen and then think about how you want to respond before you just start spilling out words. So think about that brownie mix and trying to keep it in the bowl so you can make all the brownies. How does that sound? Do you think you can remember that? Oh, this is just my brownie pan. I just wanted to show it to you.
What?
Yeah. We can't make them right now, no. Oh, but you know what we are going to do? We're actually going to collect some dimes for hunger, and so we can help feed people. So if each of you could grab a bucket, and if you're out of buckets, you can grab a cup, a mug. And then we want to slowly go around, give everyone a chance to participate. We don't want to go too fast. Okay. And then when you pick up from someone, you can say thank you. You just go visit people and say thank you. Some people might hand you money. Yeah. So go ahead and you want to walk maybe up to the top. Just walk up and down the aisles and see if people want to hand you money. I know this is a strange concept, but. Look, there's some people up here. They want to give some money. You want to walk over to them? I see that. So there's some people up on the stage here that want to give some money. I have some. Here you go, sir. We certainly appreciate everyone's donations. You can go ahead and put it back on the stage here when you're done. You do have a lot. Did anyone get missed? Okay, good. Thank you. You got to come back up here so we can say a prayer. We're going to pray over the money. And we're going to pray that if we make brownies today, that they turn out amazing. Yeah? Okay, we have a couple more coming. We're going to just leave it open. Okay, are you ready to come back to the stage? All right, here we go. Here you go. I'll give you some money.
I got too much money out there.
Oh, you did? They're so generous. Well, again, this donation that we collected is that it's going to be given to people. We have to count it, and then we're going to give it to people so they can buy food for themselves. Isn't that good? No, you don't have to count, but the adults have to count. So let's pray over the money, and let's make sure that we thank the people that gave us the donations. Thank you. Okay, everyone, put your hands together and close your eyes. You want to put those up here?
I'm going to close my eyes like this.
Okay. Okay, let's close our eyes and put our hands together. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to be patient with our words. We know that our words can hurt people, but we want them to show kindness and love because God is love. We thank you so much for your donations, the congregation of Allison Creek, and we hope that these donations land in the hands of folks that really make use of them and enjoy the food that we were able to provide. Amen.
Let's go.
Good job, guys.
With the Sarahs today, I believe. Hey, I recognize a couple of y'all as like dunking me Friday night. Y'all know anything about that?
I run up there.
Yeah, I know you dunked me on Friday night. First shot. Yeah, I said to them when they were leaving, I meant to say during the announcement, some of those kids were quite energetic in dunking me on Friday night in the dunk booth and were quite excited when they were successful, especially Brody Bolton, who showed his pitching arm quite well. Let's bow our heads in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we're so thankful to be able to have these scriptures to turn to and to be open to how they speak to us at this time. And so, gracious God, we pray that indeed your word speaks through these words. We ask all these prayers in your son's name. Amen. Well, the past few weeks in worship, we've been reading stories from Genesis, the first book of the Bible, and we've been reading about this very dysfunctional biblical family. But it's a family that God uses to bless the entire world. Now, if you've been following on, hopefully through their adventures or misadventures and their dysfunction, maybe we've been able to help understand some of our own family dysfunction and our own family struggles that we deal with in our lives. Today, we're going to wrap up these stories from Genesis and this family by focusing on Jacob and his son, Joseph. Now, today we're going to hear about the older man, Jacob, who gets to the end of his life, and he has fears about his legacy, and then his son, Joseph, who who his actions began the healing process for this family. Ultimately, this is a story about reconciliation. And isn't that what we want to see more of in this world and in our families, is reconciliation? Right, so when we left off the story last Sunday, Joseph had been sold off into slavery by his brothers and taken off into Egypt. Joseph was the next to the youngest of the 13 children to Jacob, and Jacob had these 13 children with four women. So Joseph and his brother Benjamin were the youngest of the two and the only two born to their mother, Rachel. Now, Joseph was sold into slavery by his brothers after he told them a dream he had in which his brothers would come and bow down to him, and they did not like that. So, arriving in Egypt, Joseph ends up being enslaved by Potiphar, who was second in charge to Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. Joseph worked very hard for Potiphar and ends up being promoted to being in charge of Potiphar's household responsibilities. So, but while working for Potiphar, the story gets even more dramatic because Joseph is described as very handsome and good-looking, and Potiphar's wife is attracted to Joseph and tries to seduce Joseph. Joseph rejects her seduction, and Potiphar's wife is not happy about that, so then she accuses Joseph of trying to seduce her, and so her husband Potiphar believes her story, and Joseph is sent to prison by Potiphar. So Joseph ends up in prison, and while he's in prison, he meets two men who were put in prison by the Pharaoh. And these two men each have a dream, and they end up telling their dream to Joseph, who interprets their dream correctly. So those two men get released from jail and end up going back to work for the Pharaoh. One of them dies, but the other one continues working for Pharaoh. So then Pharaoh has a dream in which he wants interpretation for this dream. And so Pharaoh reaches out to lots of folks looking for someone to interpret his dream. And this person who had been in jail with Joseph tells Pharaoh that he met somebody who may be able to interpret his dream for him. So Joseph comes in and interprets this dream that Pharaoh had, and the interpretation is that there will be 7 years of prosperity followed by 7 years of drought. So Pharaoh believes Joseph's interpretation of his dream, and so for the next 7 years, there is great prosperity in the country of Egypt. And so so during that 7 years of prosperity, Pharaoh was saving grain and also requiring all the farmers in Egypt to give a 20% tax back to Pharaoh. So they did that for 7 years, and then, like Joseph predicted, they then go through 7 years of drought. And so because they had stored up all this grain, they were able to survive that time of drought. So the drought covers the whole region. And so during those 7 years, then the farmers and the residents in Egypt and other countries all come to Egypt because they have heard that Egypt has grain to sell. So because Joseph was seen as and believed by Pharaoh, and his prediction turned out correct, Joseph was put in charge of distributing the grain to these local and foreign buyers coming to purchase grain from Egypt. So as a result, Joseph becomes very powerful. So that's when Joseph's family comes back into this story. So Joseph's brothers had sold him into slavery because they did not like him. The brothers had told their father, Jacob, that Joseph had been devoured by wild animals, and so Jacob believes that Joseph is dead. So when the drought hits the land of Canaan, Jacob tells his children to go to Egypt to buy grain so that they can survive. So they go to Egypt, and Joseph is the one that they go to try to purchase grain. Well, Joseph now has a new name. He has an Egyptian name, and he must look very different because the brothers do not recognize Joseph. But Joseph recognizes his brothers. So remember, these are the brothers that wanted to kill Joseph and eventually then sell him off into slavery. So Joseph decides at first to make it difficult for his brothers to acquire the grain that they have come to get. But eventually he provides them what they want. And this leads into today's reading, where Joseph will be revealing his identity to his brothers. So let's set the stage again, because this, you know, can be kind of complicated. So Joseph has been betrayed by his brothers and sold off into slavery. They have come begging him for help, but they do not know who Joseph is. Joseph has become quite successful in Egypt. He is second only to Pharaoh in terms of wealth. And we could say that Joseph is a self-made wealthy person who sees all of his wealth as a blessing from God. So let's read about what Joseph does when he has a chance to rub his success into his brothers' faces and to retaliate against him. So we're going to be reading from chapter 45 of Genesis.
Then Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him. So dismayed were they at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into slavery. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to keep you alive for many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh and lord of all his house and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here." Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept before them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Joseph does not reject or retaliate against his brothers. Instead, he welcomes them and provides for them out of his abundance. He does not see his wealth as something to protect, but as something to be shared with his family in need. Joseph had every right to be mean and vindictive toward his brothers. But instead, Joseph saw his plight as God's plan to use something that was meant for evil, but that God used it for something good. And as a result of this generosity, the generations of family dysfunction begin to move towards a time of healing. And what about his father, Jacob? He was a man who had witnessed in his lifetime the rape of his only daughter, the displacement of his family, the death of his wife delivering their last child, and the family conflict that led to his children selling one of his brothers into slavery. And then Jacob comes to this point at the end of life, begging a foreigner for survival. How many regrets must Jacob have had toward the end of his life? But in the midst of all this family turmoil, Joseph finds a way to seek reconciliation with the members of this family that have betrayed him. Joseph uses the resources that he has with the ones who have betrayed him. Joseph shows compassion to these ones who betrayed him. And Joseph ends the dysfunction and begins healing with the ones who betrayed him. How about you? How are you treating people who have betrayed you? And what do Joseph's actions have to teach you? Now, it is true, you can be like what you're expected to do. You can claim to be self-made and blessed by God and say that you owe nothing to the people that you feel like have betrayed you. Or you can learn from what Joseph does. You can learn from him who says that the evil done to him was in fact used by God to bring about healing. And then you can initiate the healing towards the ones that you feel like have betrayed you in some way. I find the 15th verse of our reading today to be quite important. So let me read to you again what happens after Joseph reconciles with his family. We read that Joseph kissed all his brothers and wept upon them, and after that, his brothers talked with him. That is what reconciliation looks like. When we take the step to reconcile with the ones who have betrayed us, then we open up the avenues for people to talk with one another once again. Not talk at or talk about, but to talk with. And talking with and to one another may be what healing looks like. Simply talking again to the ones who love you and whom you love. May God give you the strength to seek reconciliation with the ones whom you feel like have betrayed you in some way. In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, amen, amen. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Gracious and loving God, we're so thankful for the ways that you use something meant for evil and turn it around to something for good. And so, dear Lord, we pray to learn from Joseph and the way to seek to bring healing even to the ones who maybe we feel like have betrayed us in some way or another. So gracious and loving God, we lift up all these prayers to your Son's name. Amen. Let us respond to the message read and proclaimed by singing together hymn number 366, Love Divine, All Loves Excelling, and we'll be singing verses 1 and 3. 366, please stand if able.
Thank you.
seated. So we turn now to being a community in prayer. Different prayer requests and celebrations, please note in our bulletin this morning. Our preschool starts on Tuesday of this week, and so we will be obviously lifting the year of preschool up and the start this week, and pray that the cries are turned quickly into laughter for ones who will be away from their parents for the first time for some of them. Carolyn Finley is at Piedmont Hospital. I do not know if she has been released yet to rehab or not, but our prayers are with Carolyn as she has some fluid and on her lungs and around her heart, and so she is recuperating from that. Also lift up prayers for Ginger's son-in-law, Scott Wood, who is having surgery on Tuesday. Certainly lift up residents in Hawaii and it looks like Southern California and Northern Mexico as well with the hurricane. Several folks are dealing with COVID right now, and that's impacting this community of faith, and I know people that you know and maybe yourselves and your family, so we lift up those as well. So let's turn to God in prayer first silently, and then I will lead us in a spoken prayer. Let us pray as God's people. Eternal God, we gather with you in worship, listen to your word read and proclaimed, and discern your will for our lives. Incline your ear to us as we raise our prayers, our petitions, our joys, and our concerns. You are our rock, and we are questioning what we once assumed to be sturdy and stable. Things are changing so fast, and our options feel limited. We don't know what to do to make things better. Life can be overwhelming, and we, your people, need your help. Creator God, the natural world groans for relief as temperatures rise, as wildfires rage, and natural disasters regularly and tragically endanger lives. We pray for those without the resources to rebuild after disaster strikes. We pray for the sick whose lungs are vulnerable to polluted air. We pray for the evacuated, the refugee, the desperate, and the destitute. We pray for your earth to be renewed. Prince of Peace, save us from ourselves, our violence, and warring madness. Protect the innocent from injustice. Strengthen the honorable. Bless us all with the moral courage to follow Christ's way of love. Merciful God, we are not without help or hope. Acts of compassion inspire in the face of all that is hard and harsh. Communities are collaborating to meet needs in new and exciting ways. People long silence are finding their voice. We are newly aware of what we can accomplish when we work together for the flourishing of your kingdom. Holy God, the greatest threats are those that lead us to lock ourselves down, to close our minds and hearts, and to build barriers to divide and protect. May your Spirit encourage our faith as we stand open-hearted, praying and believing in your endless mercy. Gracious God, we lift up those prayer concerns and celebrations in our hearts and minds this day. We lift up our prayer family for Ben and Carrie and Nathan and Ashlyn and Olivia. Lift up prayers for our session, including Wendy, as it gathers to this day. We lift up prayers for our session, including Mike, and we lift up prayers for our prayer church, Mount Pleasant Presbyterian in Chester County. We lift up prayers for those in Hawaii and Southern California and Northern Mexico facing the ravages of fires and hurricanes. We lift up prayers for Allison Creek Preschool as it begins this year and begins its moving toward its 20th year of ministry in our community. We lift up prayers of healing for Carolyn Finley and prayers of healing for Scott Wood and prayers for those who are dealing with COVID at this time. So gracious and loving God, we lift up these and all our prayers as well as the prayer which you teach us, which we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. God indeed has blessed us in many, many rich and wonderful ways. Let us respond to God's goodness by the bringing forth of our offerings at this time. Together with our offering prayer as printed in our bulletin this morning. Blessed are you, O God, maker of all things. Through your goodness, you have blessed us with these gifts, ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Use us in what we have gathered, in feeding the world with your love. To the one who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. For we have been blessed and nurtured and guided for, so let us join together and depart by singing Take My Life, hymn number 697, verses 1, 2, and 6. Let us join together in singing Take My Life. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of God's Holy Spirit be with us this day and every day. And may all God's people say a mighty amen. God bless us all.
Western Bay, and it serves 100 ships a day. Lonely sailors pass the time away and talk about their homes.
girl in this harbor town, and she works laying whiskey down.